Okay, this thing, you guys hear me now? Okay, good. Yeah, got it now? Good, thanks. Okay, thanks for coming by. My name is Chris McClish. I'm the medical director of the cardiac cath lab, Shannon West Texas Memorial Hospital in San Angelo. And the purpose of our talk today is to discuss radial cardiac catheterization in a community setting. We've been doing heart caths from a radial approach at Shannon for about 3 years now, but really over the last 2 years have made a dedicated effort to make radial our first access and have had good results with it so far. And our clicker's kind of flaking out on us today, so hang in there. Okay, this is my experience. I'm graduated from University of Texas Medical Branch in 1998, did my medicine and fellowship training in Charlottesville, Virginia at the university there, and then did my interventional training UT Health Science Center San Antonio. Now, along the lines in there, I did a few radial heart casts in fellowship, but really not very many. It was not nearly as widely accepted and not as popular a topic as it is now. Our experience at Shannon, we've just come by on our own. And this is a picture of our facility. Currently, we have about 250 licensed adult inpatient beds, all telemetry units, 53,000 annual ER visits, 13,500 annual admissions. We do about 160 cardiothoracic surgeries annually and about 1,600 cath cases annually. About 65% of those now are utilizing radial access between myself and my partner. Here's a picture of our new cardiac cath lab up front, which is the Toshiba 5-axis Infinix system, the same one that's behind me here you can see after the presentation if you're interested in seeing it up close. We chose this system after we had decided to make a dedicated move to radial cases, specifically because this was so effective and flexible for that type of approach. So we started using radials at Shannon primarily for the improved patient benefits, of course. Firstly, there's a lower risk of vascular complications, and that's well established. That's the primary reason people get interested in radials in the first place. There also clearly is reduced major bleeding, well documented, and a reduced hospital stay. On average, from the literature, post-procedure total hospital stay are reduced, leading to about a 9% reduction in total hospital charges. We do have improved patient comfort. And much faster ambulation times. And in our experience, anecdotally, we've had many patients coming to our facility for their heart cath specifically because we're the guys in town who do radial procedures. So our protocol that we've adopted, we use a micropuncture access kit to place a 5-French hydrophilic glide sheath over a nitinol wire. The first several cases that we did not use the hydrophilic glide sheath. We had much higher rate of vasospasm, arterial spasm, and it's shown in the literature that the length of the sheath is not as important as having a hydrophilic coating. That's what really does the most to reduce the spasm. Through the arterial sheath, then, we give 500 micrograms nitroglycerin, 500 mics of verapamil, 2,500 units of unfractionated heparin to try and reduce the incidence of radial artery thrombosis. And then diagnostic angiograms are done using a 5-French catheter. I use a Jackie catheter, which is a specific radial catheter, but Judkin's catheters using a JL 3.5 and a JR4 also work fine. It just requires more exchanges to do that, and the more exchanges you have, the more likely you are to have vasospasm. And then ventriculography is done with a 5-French pigtail. On occasion, we will use an end-hole Terumo catheter for our ventriculograms, provided the catheter sits quietly in the ventricle and is in a good position. Obviously, you don't want to do end-hole injections with the catheter not in a good position. And then we use, for coronary and LV injections, we use an assist power injector device. And the benefits of the assist are that it allows you to push the contrast through a 5-French catheter and get good diagnostic angiograms, even on patients who are tachycardic or who have LVH and have a tougher time filling those arteries. I think that using a power injector in this way is really helpful for these kinds of cases. As far as interventions and guide support, we use typically extra backup guides, EBUs, XBLADs, for the left coronary. In our lab, we use 5- and 6-French guides. There is data using 7-French guides, particularly in men, but we haven't done that yet in our lab, and it would be rare that we would need that, to be honest. And then a variety of guides for right coronary access, JRs, hockey sticks, RBUs, AMPLATS guides. I also tend to use extra support wires as buddy wires to stabilize the guide, and I have a case to show you in a minute where that's helpful. When you're first learning to do radials, one of the things I found was it is more difficult. You don't have as much support for the catheter, particularly in difficult lesions, tortuous anatomy. And using an extra support wire as a buddy wire, Ironman or Grand Slam, to hold the guide in really effectively, I think it turns a 5-French guide or a 6-French guide into acting more like a 7 or 8 French device and allows you to deliver devices much easier. And you can also consider a guideliner, extra support kind of catheter going through your catheter and deliver your balloons and stents that way. And then at the end of the case, we use a compression band to hold pressure on the radial site. We do that for all our cases, diagnostic and intervention. Certainly particularly for diagnostic cases with only 2,500 units of heparin, you could pull the sheath and hold pressure. The compression band has been very useful to us. Not only does it help with our turnover time and our throughput in the lab, but we've had very good results as far as hemostasis. Okay, so over the last 2 years, we've done a total of 1,100 radial heart casts at Shannon. And again, about 65% of our volume there now. And thus far, in our experience, we've had very few complications. We have had 2 cases of radial artery perforation with extravasation of contrast that was confirmed on angiogram. Both of those cases were just managed with local compression. We did get a vascular surgery consult, but it was felt no further intervention was necessary. Neither of those patients developed a compartment syndrome or had to have a surgical intervention. And so far, we've not had any case requiring a surgical intervention and no loss of hand function or sensation, no claudication, that kind of thing after the procedure. The most common complaint that we see when people return for follow-up is that particularly in female patients, will sometimes see pain in their forearm, which I think is likely from vasospasm during the case and some nerve sort of compression from the band compression device. That's all self-limited. It responds well just to typical anti-inflammatories, and they do well. And in our lab, obviously, it's superior to femoral access and reducing bleeding. The data on that is overwhelming. That's the number one benefit of radials. It's important not only for reducing major bleeding, but in reducing minor bleeding as far as patient discomfort and the calls you get in the middle of the night to come see the patient out of hematoma. You know, what's reported is 1% risk of groin site complications. That's the number we was taught in fellowship. Everyone knows that number's obviously low. If you ask patients and you do enough femoral sticks, especially now with heparin and tegrelin and a higher dose of Plavix and so forth, you see a lot more than that. And radial has really cut that down significantly in our lab. And it is clearly preferred by the patients. As I said, we have a lot of patients now who come to our hospital, come to our clinic specifically because we can do the procedure from a radial and gives us that competitive advantage in our town and in our referral community as well. So, as I said, the Toshiba system behind us, behind this wall here that you can see after, we chose that after my partner and I had decided that we were going to make a dedicated shift to radials and stick with it. The system is very, very flexible, and it allows for lateral movement. You can go all the way from fingertip to fingertip without having to break the table and sort of move the patient over this way. And that's helpful sometimes during catheter exchanges in the middle of a procedure when you're trying to pass one catheter up for another, when you don't have to break the table and get yourself out of alignment in the middle of the case. The system is very flexible. That what you saw there was a left sided access. We have some pictures of that later. This is, and obviously the image quality, I think on most flat panel detectors these days, the image quality is really quite good. This is their subtracted stepping protocol for an angiogram we shot in our lab. We've been very happy with the image quality so far. Okay, so common concerns of radials, and these are the things you have to overcome when you're trying to decide if you're going to try starting radials in your own practice. This was a list that was in Dr. Kern's paper from 2009. The first concern is that radial casts are slow. That's what you hear, and it takes a while. There is a learning curve certainly associated with doing radials. For the first 25 cases or so, it takes a while to get your hands around it. But what's reported in the literature, in high-volume operators, on average, 40-minute case for a radial, 37 minutes for a femoral, not a big difference. In our lab now, having done several hundred of these, or over 1,000 of these now, we I really don't think there's much difference in the time, honestly, between doing a radial and a femoral. It takes a while to get comfortable with access. Obviously, the radial artery is a little bit more challenging to get the sheath in good position, but that's not always true these days. And we see a lot of patients who are morbidly obese who are coming to the cath lab with coronary disease, and I think we can do their case safer from a radial approach and faster, honestly, than we can from a femoral. Another thing you'll hear now is that, well, femoral closure devices work well, so we don't, you know, what's the need for radial access? I just don't think it's true. Femoral closure devices do work. There's one study, I guess, showing that Angio-Seal is better than manual compression in acute coronary syndrome patients, but by and large, femoral closure devices have not been shown to significantly reduce hematoma or other vascular complications. Comparatively, radial access, however, does reduce major bleeding about 73% compared with femoral access. One concern that people will say is, well, how do I know if I get in the middle of the diagnostic, I may need a bigger guide or I may need an intra-aortic balloon pump if there were an emergency during the case. Our solution to that in our lab is that we prep the groin for every case. So even if the patient has a radial, they're told beforehand, we will shave and prep your groin. We can get that access if we need it. And the other thing I would say is that if you needed to put a balloon pump in emergently, you're still going to have to access the contralateral groin anyway in the middle of your procedure so that you can finish your intervention. And so I don't think that that's really a valid concern. And another concern people have is that you may not be able to use the post-cath radial artery as a bypass conduit. There is a small study from Japan that showed a reduced graft patency compared to for a radial if it had been used for a cath compared to a radial that had never been touched before. There's a study coming out, I think they're presenting that tomorrow, showing radial bypass patency versus saphenous veins anyway. In our hospital, the surgeons do not have a concern using radial arteries when they think it's appropriate. Sometimes they'll simply excise the distal portion where you made your access and use the remainder of the conduit. Another concern that you'll hear is more radiation exposure. In the literature, on average, there is slightly more radiation exposure for radials versus femorals. Of course, radiation exposure is a function of time in the lab and distance. But as your time improves, as you get over that learning curve and as you're faster, your radiation exposure overall certainly will be less. And then loss of radial artery pulse. That does occur in about 3 to 9% of patients who have a radial cath. Even with heparin and the other things. This is an asymptomatic condition, provided that their Allen's test is okay and they have dual radial and ulnar circulation to the hand. We check that with two methods. We do a visual color assessment as I'm screening people for the procedure, and then we also do a pulse oximeter right before the procedure is done to verify that we have good waveform through both arteries. Patients with a bypass surgery and an IMA will require a left-sided approach, and in the lab that we had before, that was very difficult because we'd have to pull the left arm over the abdomen, which was not a very stable position, especially if you have a real obese patient and you're working from the right side of the table. Or, so you either had to pull their arm over and do your procedure this way, or you had to go around to the left side of the table and then look backwards over your head at the monitors, which is a terrible way to try and do a heart cath. But with this system, this is us doing a left-sided approach in a bypass patient. The monitors on the five-axis system float freely, so you can move those all around the patient bed to put them wherever you want. And so we do now left-sided bypasses from the patient's left side with the arm extended. We're able to put the table down in line with the arm so we have a good working base for catheter exchanges with the techs. And then put the monitors right up on top where you don't have to look back and strain your neck doing procedures. We're now doing the majority of our bypasses that way. Obviously, those patients have more complex anatomy, higher likelihood of interventions, but we've had good success with that so far. Okay, so just a couple of interesting cases. This is a case of a patient who had a right coronary ST elevation MI, was treated with a lytic at an outside facility, and then flown in to Shannon on the helicopter. And on the right, you'll see the heavily thrombotic lesion in the right coronary. There is flow past that lesion at this time, but the patient was still having chest pain and still had some residual ST elevation. So he's taken directly to the cath lab. with a lytic on board. Obviously, there's concern, much higher risk of femoral bleeding in those patients, and we did this procedure from right radial access. Now, you'll notice in the first pane over there, we're having trouble engaging the radial. That was with a JR, and even switching to it, eventually we switched to an RBU guide, but even with that switch, we still had trouble keeping it in the ostium. So this picture on the right is now the guide in position with an extra support wire. That's what I was talking about earlier. That's a grand slam wire that's pushed down into the distal right coronary. With that extra support wire in place, you have much better guide position, much stronger guide. This was done with a 6 French, by the way. And then after getting good guide position, we were able to dilate and deploy a stent in the proximal right coronary with a great result. This patient did very well. He was a quick presenter, and I think the lytic from the outside hospital helped him. He has a residual lesion in the LAD that needs to be done eventually. It was not done in this setting, obviously. This guy actually lives about 350 miles from our hospital. He lives in a totally different part of Texas. And he is going to come back to our hospital to have his LAD done just because nobody in his community can do it from a radial approach. And so he's going to drive all the way back over there to have his facility or to have his procedure done with us. It's another interesting case from our lab, an example of a radial loop. This is something you can't predict before you get in there, and it's one of the things I tell patients is about 1 out of 20 cases when we try radials, we don't see this 1 out of 20 times, but about 1 out of 20 times now we won't be able to do the procedure from a radial for one reason or another. The first picture on the right is the loop, and if you look, it looks like from where we are here that we should be able just to go right past up into the brachial artery, no problem. You see the loop, but it's really hard to tell anatomically where it is. When you rotate the camera down to a, we move their camera out over the elbow and then roll it down to a caudal position, now you can clearly see that the loop here is compromising our wire passage up, and so we abandoned the radial and moved on to a femoral approach. And then this is no-no. So subclavian disease like that, we see we were able to pass the wire down there and actually got it in position. We didn't really attempt to even pass a catheter through that. We abandoned this, moved down to femoral, and had a good result there. So overall, in conclusion, I think radial artery access is undeniably the future of cardiac catheterization. The rival data is to be presented tomorrow on radial versus femoral approach in acute coronary syndromes. I think a lot of people are expecting that to show a big benefit for radials, particularly with all the additional anticoagulation on board. I would not be surprised, personally, if we start seeing pretty strong indications, recommendations in the PCI guidelines to say consider radial artery access under the following conditions. And I think the demands will be for fellows to be trained more in radial catheterization, et cetera. But I think our success in our hospital so far with our program proves that even if you didn't get that radial training when you were going through that point, it's not too late to try and learn how to do it. This system, as I said, we bought the Toshiba camera specifically because it's proven so flexible, and we've been very happy with it so far. That's it. I'm glad to take any questions.